Hello to you, friends. This is Stammer on air, but first, a daily, early Buddhist contemplation. All beings are born and created by their karma. They are formed, shaped, conditioned, elevated, and restricted by their karma. These past actions, this past behavior, is the womb of probability from which they reemerge. All beings are owners of their karma, debtors to their karma, and they inherit their karma. Whatever they do, whether good or bad, the later effects of that will be theirs only. This accumulation of probability follows them like a shadow of the past that never leaves. Therefore does this karma come to divide all beings into high and low, beautiful or ugly. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 52, recorded on the 6th January 2017. So Happy New Year to you. I think it will be a splendid, splendid year, this 2017. But let's see. It has not come yet. There's one simile, one karma story, and two questions. But first, the normal intro as usual. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha indeed. The simile is a simile very often given by the Buddha on fire. He gave it to several places. He likened consciousness and being in itself as a fire. A fire that burns on ignorance and craving. Most famous is probably the Fire Sutta, where he speaks to several hundred ascetics, which has the superstition that they are fire worshippers. They think that if they kindle a fire and it doesn't go out all their life, then they will have a happy rebirth and a happy destiny. This is, of course, completely folly superstition, of which there is many today, and we will go through some of them during the karma story on Venerable Sivadi, which has been an object, unfortunately, for amulet making in Asia, which is a commercial practice based on superstition. But more on that later. This is from the Greater Discourse on the Destruction of Craving. It's Majjhima Nikaya, which you see here. Number 38, there's 152 suttas in that, middle-length speeches of the Buddha. And this is from the Mahatana Sankhya Sutta, the Greater Discourse on the Destruction of Craving. I'll give the link below so you can find it. It's free on my website. So there he says that he tries to delineate in what role consciousness has in the promulgation and arising and continuation of the process of suffering, dukkha. Why so? Because there's a monk, which is a fisherman's son, which might be the later, the former rebirth of Nichiren, the Japanese monk, who also had some fairly absurd views, and which have even a large horde of followers today. But this fisherman's son, Sati, he claimed that It's the same consciousness that is now, that is reborn later and experiences the result of good and bad. So he thinks it was the same consciousness all along. And so monks tries to explain it to him that this is not the case. There are six kinds of consciousness that arise upon conditions. And then when these conditions cease, then this consciousness also cease. And it's momentarily, it cease right where it arised. So independent on the eye and the visual forms, visual consciousness arise, awareness of the seen, consciousness of something is seen, namely form and colors. So this, the Buddha, he likened to firewood on good firewood, because it flames up a lot, it becomes very visual. And the same thing he said, independence on bush twigs, then the dry bush twigs, there burns at the fire, which is very smelly because there's a lot of smokes from these twigs. And so also independence on the smell and the nose, olfactory consciousness, consciousness of the smelt arises. So also he said, with grass or cow dung, cow dung was dried at that time, it still is in India, and then used as firewood. He classified fire burning on cow dung was the same as gustatory consciousness, because dung, excrement, is what is left over from what is tasted, passes down and come out the other end as excrement. And so also you can say with gustatory consciousness, it arises independent of what is tasted and the tongue. So also he said with tactile consciousness, it's like a fire burning on straw, because straw is quickly lost in the fire. It burns up almost immediately. And so also the tactile touch, as soon as the touch leaves the skin, then you cannot feel anything anymore. So tactile consciousness arising on the skin and whatever can be touched, whatever object can be touched. This is very fragile. It's like straw burning. It disappears momentarily. And as fire, independence on rubbish is classified as a rubbish fire, so also mental consciousness is a rubbish fire. Why so? Because it burns on rubbish, is swept up from somewhere else, dirt and rubbish. And so also consciousness of the mental is like thinking about what you have perceived through the other six senses. You're thinking about something you have seen, or something one has tasted or touched, like sex, or some memories from before. It's all old sensations that turns on the thinking, conceptual thinking, which the Buddha liked to a rubbish fire. So if unaware and not dwelling in mindfulness of the body as a corpse, as a skeleton, and not dwelling in infinite mind, in infinite sympathy for all beings, infinite friendliness, infinite compassion, infinite mutual joy in their success, and infinite equanimity and serenity. Then when one sees a form with the eye, then arises eye contact. And this, due to this eye contact, visual consciousness arises. When there is contact, there comes also feeling. And if unaware, one takes delight in this feeling. If something delightful to be seen, then one favors the sensation. If it's something ugly, disagreeable to be seen, then one is repulsed by the sensation. So in both cases, craving arises, either craving towards the object or craving away from the object. From craving comes clinging, and from clinging comes becoming. And for becoming comes birth, aging, sickness, and death. And so is the arising of this whole mass of suffering. So the moment one takes delight, then there's clinging, if unaware. If aware, there doesn't need to be clinging. It doesn't need to be clinging. There's still sensation, one still sees, and Arahat still sees the same object as you and I. But he doesn't cling to them, and he doesn't delight in the feeling that arises in dependence upon this visual contact, olfactory contact, gustatory, when he tastes something, gustatory contact, or tactile contact, or whatever kind of contact he has with the external world. He doesn't take delight in it. And because of that, then he don't create any future. Why so? Because the process of becoming stops right there. He doesn't accumulate any new becoming. He has a karmic bank of probabilities for new becoming. But otherwise, if one takes delight in the sensation, in the visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, gustatory consciousness, when tasting something, when having the ice cream in, tasting the touch, or the tongue, and the taste, sweet taste, if one takes delight right there, then one is creating future moments. One is creating future consciousness. One is creating future rebirth. Now, both of the moment and of the life. And this, of course, creates suffering, because if there is rebirth of the moment, there will also be death of the moment. And if there's a rebirth of the life, of the body, and of the life process, then there will also be aging, sickness, and death. And that is indeed suffering. So it's in dependence upon this consciousness that delight arises. Because contact is defined by three things. There has to be a sensory organ, the eye, for example, or eye visibility, the ability to see. And there has to be something to be seen, a form or color. And then in dependence upon these two, visual consciousness arises. And the co-occurrence of these three, the eye, the form, and visual consciousness, that is contact, passa. Immediately after this contact is occurring, then feeling arises. And it's right there one should be cautious, because whether it's a delightful feeling or a painful feeling, frustrating feeling, disappointed feeling, and then craving arises, either towards the object or away from the object. And this creates clinging. From clinging comes becoming. From becoming comes birth, aging, sickness, and death, of the moment, of the life, of the body. So suffering arises right there. So one can say, if we go through dependent arising once again, it is because of ignorance that mental construction arises. It's because of mental construction that consciousness arises. It's because of consciousness and naming and forming, mentality and materiality, body and mind arise in the rebirth moment during transmigration. And it's because of that that you get six senses, eye and ear and so on. Because there is six senses, there is contact. Because there's contact, there's feeling, vedana. Because there's feeling, there's craving, if unaware. Because there's craving, there's clinging. Because there's clinging, there's becoming. Because there's becoming, there arises birth, aging, sickness, and death. So is the arising of this whole mass of suffering. So if one cuts down at ignorance end of this 12-point chain, then it doesn't end up with suffering. If there's no ignorance, then there will be no mental construction. Then there will be no consciousness. Then there will be no name and form, no six senses, no contact, no feeling, no craving, no clinging, no becoming, no birth, rebirth of the moment, of the conscious being. And thereby aging, sickness, and death, and thereby suffering. There will be no such thing if there's no ignorance. Ignorance of what? If there's knowledge in every moment and in every life, but in particular in every moment of the Four Noble Truths, then this, all this is suffering, All this is suffering. And the arising of suffering is craving. The cause of suffering is craving. An absence of craving equals absence of suffering. And the Fourth Noble Truth is that the noble way, the noble eightfold way, is the method to end suffering by ending craving. So if this knowledge is there in every moment, then one doesn't take delight in the object, nor in the feeling caused by contact with the object. One doesn't take delight. Why not? Because one knows in advance, a priori, before sensation, that whatever arises out there or in here, that only is and always was and always will be one thing, and that is suffering. Then one doesn't cling to that. One discards it or let it pass. Then it's much more easy to have contact with the world, because one is not craving for it or craving away from it. There's a world, yes, there's a world. So what? As Miles Davis put it, so what? Ba-dap, 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 ba-dap. So much go for the consciousness fire, the fire of desire, the desire fire, causing craving, clinging, becoming, rebirth, and thus transmigration and thereby suffering. If we take the rebirth exact moment, what happens there? Because this maybe might be good to know from a Buddhist perspective. What is Buddhist perspective of being on the conception moment? So the Buddha said that there's three kinds of becomings, or you can say. There's a mother and father that's united through copulation, but the mother doesn't have her egg, she's not ovulated, there's no egg going down in the womb. And so even though semen is present from the father, there will be no conscious being arising there. Then there's a case where she has her season, and there is an egg in the going down to the womb, and the semen is also there, but there's no conscious being that has to be reborn there. And then the egg is not fertilized, or the egg is fertilized by the semen, but it falls out with the menstruation. This we know as doctors, this happens in 60% of the cases. So a fertilized egg falls out with the normal menstruation before the female recognizes by lack of menstruation that she's pregnant. This is happening in 2/3 of the cases, fairly common. However, if there is a being present in this particular moment that has to be reborn, then the conception, where three things meet, the egg, the sperm cell, and the conscious being, the consciousness of the being, egg meets there. Then the fetus will complete its development and there will be a baby born. How does the consciousness actually happen to fall out right there? We can describe from two angles, actually. The being experiences in a split second, but in subjective time, normal time going behind, but time is probably going much faster at that particular for that particular being in that particular moment. But they experience it as they see their mother and father having sex. And then they feel an irresistible desire to enter the womb of the mother. And this, when right after they have felt this irresistible desire to enter the womb, they're kind of like sucked in there, because their consciousness is basically non-local. It has no form. It's not connected to anybody, to any materiality. This is the biological way of explaining it. How, from seen from a physical point of view or modern psychology point of view? Yes, so the conscious being, the consciousness that has to arise in the next moment, just after it has died, it has a desire to be conscious, otherwise it wouldn't happen. And an arahat consciousness that stops at the moment of death doesn't re-arise. But one who likes to be conscious, has desire to be consciousness, is not awakened like being. This consciousness will seek a new body, because the other body is decaying to the extent where it cannot support a consciousness. Then it has some probabilities going along with it. It has a frequency and also a field of probabilities. And this field of probability will propel the locality aspect of this consciousness into where there is less resistance. This means that the conditions that is in these probabilities, they will try to find a path or a place or a location where the circumstances fits its own karmic probability patterns. So this means if you have a probability distribution for some events in some physical condition, for example, a mother, a father, and their exile, and their future, and their past, will be they are living on a certain planet and a certain species, in a certain family, rich or poor, and so on. There is a whole set of a priori probabilities there for certain events happening and certain events for not happening. So we can say it's like these probabilities are this in high, it's kind of like a probability distribution. Then the consciousness also comes with a probability distribution. And if these two fits, then the consciousness will enter the womb of that particular female. So it's a fit of two probability distributions which look alike. And this means that if you subtract them, you get the minimal difference. So this is the path of less resistance it takes. It takes a split second, then it's already happened. Why so? Because the consciousness is non-local at that particular moment. It is not local. It doesn't have a form. It doesn't have a body. So it's non-local. It is to be, what is non-locality? How is to be seen? Yeah, you can say the consciousness, this also goes for our consciousness to some extent. The consciousness at that particular moment is everywhere present. So it is no particular place. It is only when it starts to perceive from a particular perspective that its particular, a particle aspect, local aspect, it arises. And this perspective of its perception will arise there where there is less resistance, where there is less difference between the probabilities, the field, probability field, external probability field, and its own probability field. And these two, when these two are matched, then it will fall out there. It's the same thing about a process going into an equilibrium. It will also search through a lot of processes of local minima. For example, if you have a basin where there's various holes and troughs and valleys, then you have a ball, then you vibrate the basin, then the ball, it will go, eventually fall into the small local minima, but it will end up in the deepest point at a given time point. And so this is the minimal energy point where this equilibrium state is. And so also with the consciousness, because of the vibration, it will find the path where the probabilities match its own probabilities to the largest extent. And this will be the minimum difference, like the minimum energy of the ball that falls down into the vibrating tray where there's a various local minima. So if the process always tries to find a global minima, dynamic processes always tries to find the global minima. And consciousness in that particular moment tries to find the global minima on the difference between its own probabilities and the external probabilities. And that it does spontaneously, without wanting it or willing it. It happens automatically. It's kind of physical, you could say. It's more physical than mental. Nevertheless, we go to question number 26 minutes in. Question number 171. Did the Buddha also struggle with sense desire until gaining jhana? Was this only in his last life or in his past life? And what's the context to our meditation practice? And yes, he did. He actually said so, that before, both before, it's regarded both before in his former lives and also in this his last life. Then before gaining the jhana, the pleasure of the jhana, which is so exquisite, then one is still attracted to other sense pleasures. This means one has to struggle with the clinging to them, to the attachment to them, to the obsession with them, to the sensomania with them. And this is because if mind doesn't have, if you starve mind, doesn't give it something else, And this is what Buddhism, often said in Buddhism, is not relinquishing one kind of pleasure without getting something else. You have a low kind of pleasure, and then you get a higher one, then so you go to the higher one. If you have a low kind of happiness and you get a higher happiness, then it's better to give up the lower happiness to get a higher happiness. So it's good business. There's good happiness economy in it. But before you get the higher happiness, if this not is present, in this case jhana, then it's very difficult to let go of this sense pleasure issue, which has been plaguing one for innumerable existences. Because this craving is constantly present. Just notice when you, from one moment to the next moment, usually is so mind tries to go from one sense pleasure to the next. So if it's finished eating ice cream, then it starts, what's up now? What should I do now? Should I see a film, or should I go to a party, or should I take a drink, or should I smoke a cigarette, or what should I do? So it's constantly scanning for pleasure, whether it's conscious or subconscious to the individual. The mind is scanning for sense pleasure. And this is because it doesn't know any other pleasure than sense pleasure. This just means that it doesn't have any other source of happiness than sense pleasure. That only gives momentary happiness. Huh? As soon as you take the spoon out the mouth, the happiness of the ice cream, the soft ice, goes down. Then you have to take a new spoon, until you become very, very fat and very, very unhappy. But as soon as the first jhana has been established, then one doesn't doesn't feel any sorrow or panic or relinquishing all kind of sense pleasure. Because this jhana is so exquisite, that I would say any kind of maximal orgasm or drug experience, intoxication with any kind of drug, is like a mosquito bite compared to the first jhana. And this is because it is a very, very rare. In the orgasm, you have the excitation. It's kind of like getting an electric shock, and you cannot keep it up for more than 6 or 7 seconds like that. Huh? And in the drug addiction, you have the side effects of being dull and out of your mind. You cannot think properly. You're not clear. So there's no clearness. Or you're overly excited, for example, during cocaine. You think you can do everything, you can walk on water, but if you try to walk on water, then obviously you fall through. So there's a lot of falling through with these drug addictions. So both of them have side effects and kind of like ruins the show compared to jhana, where there is exquisite pleasure, both of the body and the mind. And there's a happiness, but it's joined with calm clearness. And this calm clarity and a very deep feeling of peace together with this happiness, this is unseen and unheard of before. And every individual, I think I can say without exception, that tries to get first jhana just in 10 seconds, or maybe even less, 7 seconds, 6 seconds, they get addicted to it immediately. And then they'll try to find back to it for years. And this can be difficult because if there's craving, sense desire present, then jhana doesn't happen. And since craving for jhana is a sense desire because it's a mental state, so it's craving after a mental state. Sense desire is a sense of the mind. The mind wants to sense something special, unique in this case. Then it can often close the door to jhana, which is very frustrating for the long-term meditator. He or she has tried something, and it was exquisite. Unlike something else that maybe have tried in their entire karmic career, in numerous hundred thousands of lives. And then they start wanting it very much, and then it doesn't happen for 10 years. But it can also be that if they see this danger, by having been told this now, that they come around this obstacle of craving for a particular mental state, which is, you can say, to some extent the same as the drug addiction, the heroin addict craving for his heroin, or the marijuana smoker craving for his marijuana, or his alcohol drinker craving for alcohol. They're also craving not for the drug itself, but for the mental state it induces. So it's similar craving. It causes similar but not like suffering. So this one just you should see. If one doesn't crave, one can develop the conditions and the prerequisites for jhana to happen. But then it's just like going up in front of a door. And if it doesn't crave it, then you don't reach for the handle. But if you don't reach for the handle, the door will go up. Then you are already inside without taking a step. But if you rush up to the door and grab the handle and try, then you'll find the door locked. It'll never open, however much you pull in it. Craving creates suffering. It's also true in this instance, on the pillow. So yes, and the Buddha also struggled with this, and there's nothing unnatural in that. But as soon as he had the first jhana and went up to the other jhanas, then he could give up the sense pleasure. Then there's a question 172. What does it signify when seeing colors or patterns during meditation? In general, I would say one can feel many different experiences during meditation. And it's normal because mind comes into a place where there's very calm and nothing really happens. No conditioning is pushing on, obvious conditions. And then all kinds of things can bubble up from the deeper layers of the mind. And this, they can manifest as anything whatsoever. And it doesn't have any real signification. It's maybe a sign that there is a modest amount of progress. Because now mind is let loose to let the more weirdo experiences bubble through, which was suppressed before. It can be like feeling that you're a volcano, or feeling you're an iceberg, or feeling you're under the water, or you're becoming bigger and bigger out in free space, or you're becoming a galaxy, or colors, or patterns, or nightmares, all kinds of things, perceptions happening. And they doesn't mean anything whatsoever. Except of in one case, you can characterize them as mental noise. It's a boiling pot, and then there's something bubbling over, coming over the spill, the rim of the pot. So it's kind of like milk boiling over. The mental constructions here signify the boiling milk. In the case of color, clear colors, only uniform monochrome colors like blue, yellow, white, red, then it can signify one thing, and that is one has done kasina meditation, entirety meditation before on the blue kasina or on the yellow kasina if one sees yellow color, or in red kasina one will have tendency to have red colors on the entire visual fields without any detail. And this is also a good sign that maybe one should try a kasina meditation with the particular color one has seen during the meditation. But one can also see colors without having any experience with kasina meditation. So in general, it's better to regard it as mental noise. And then label mental noise, junk, passing by, and then go back to the meditation object. If one starts following rather grotesque, but very colorful, fanciful fantasies, then one gets lost in this world. And then half an hour later, down at the pillow, then one will recognize that one is not in volcano, or one is not Superman, or one cannot walk on water, even though these crazy perceptions somehow insinuated or pointed to that. So there can be childish dreams there. There can be all kinds of noise, mental noise. And what just not notice it and label it. Mental noise, junk passing. Skip it. Go back to the meditation object. Back to the meditation object. Always back to the meditation object. Sitting and having colorful fantasies is like dreaming. Dreaming has nothing to do with meditation. And it's not particularly advantageous either. And same thing has daydreaming and fantasies bubbling over on the meditation pillow. It's not advantageous. It's mind running free, running amok, spilling over whatever it has accumulated of past experiences, memories, perceptions, dreams, wishes, and all kinds of other junk. So forget that. Come back to the meditation object. That is advantageous. That is a method towards deathlessness. Running around in the forest of funny perceptions, it can be likened to go into the crazy house in an amusement park. It's the same. It's the same. There's many crazy houses, and there's also many amusement parks. But you always have to come out of the amusement park and pay your bill, pay your ticket afterwards. So come back to reality and come back to the meditation object. Always, always, always. It usually first happens when one is aware of it. Because usually if one is captivated by these experiences, these fantasies, and obsessed by them, then one follows along. And this can take minutes, hours, before one experiences suddenly, what am I doing? I'm sitting thinking and this and that and having these funny perceptions of colors, of patterns, and volcanoes, and icebergs, and you name it, what I'm doing. Then one quickly can return to the meditation object. But it's awareness, sati, mindfulness of this mental noise going on. So whenever you see something funny, something weirdo, something junky, then just label it. Notice it, label it. Mental noise, junk, back to the meditation object. Haul the mind back, and anchor it on the meditation object, and then take it from there. One tends to overinterpret dreams. One also tends to overinterpret these special signs and whatever blue colors or patterns or experiences as this and that and blah, 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 and this and that will happen. And later down the road, one will realize that this was completely unrealistic thinking, wishful thinking, childish dreams, all kinds of junk accumulated. Hauled up, boiling over, mental noise. The last, 40 minutes in. I'm trying to make this a little shorter. Because of the attention deficit of human beings, they can only see 7 minutes on average of a YouTube video. And my videos are 1 hour. So this means that they only see the intro. So I try to make them a little shorter. This Sekama story is about a late-born Arahant called Sivari Thera, the Prince of the Receivers. And this was it was that I speak about him is because I have several requests from people who are working in the business world in Singapore about this Sivari Thera, which was called the Prince of the Receivers by the Buddha, the foremost of those who receive gifts because of his special life story. And his life story was like this, and once you just think about it, it's very unusual, but unusual events, rare events, are not impossible. Let's say that a meteor of 10 by 10 kilometers fall down on Earth. Is that impossible? No, it's not. There is craters from this size. But then major disasters happen. It happens maybe 1 out of 1 million years, like that. Huh? So, but this is not impossible. Then 1 out of 100 million years, this is not impossible either. It's just very rare events. So very rare events are not unnatural or impossible. They are just rare events happening very, very rarely because of very, very special circumstances. And so also it was with this Sivari. His mother, Subhavasa, she first gave birth to him. She bore around on him on 7 years and 7 days. And his birth also, birth process also took 7 days. And then she said to her husband, go and give a gift to the Buddha before I die in my name. And so the Buddha, he asked Mahamoyogana, who also was coming with a gift, to wait because this husband was coming. The husband gave a gift on her behalf, on his wife's behalf. And right when he handed over the gift, she gave birth to Sivari. And he was then 7 years old when he came out. He could walk and speak. the Buddha, he and Sariputta went out and talked with the mother after this very laborious 7-day-long birth process. Must be very painful to give birth to a 7-year-old boy that can walk and talk. Sariputta talked with the boy Shivali and ordained him right on the spot. And when they took him back to the monastery with his mother's allowance, then when they clip off the first hair of his head and this falls to the ground, then he become a stream entrant. And when the second hair fell, second clip, he became a Sakadagami. Then he went out into the jungle in a hut, just like I'm staying here. And then he meditated upon the causes why he had to lie in there in his mother's womb for 7 years. And because of this repeated speculation or meditation upon that object, he attained arahatship. And then they ask the Buddha, what was the cause that he had to stay there in there for 7 years? And this is the cause the Buddha went saw that he has been a prince where another king took his mother, which was also his mother in this life, Subhavasa. And then he made a siege on the king's city for 7 days until after these 7 days has happened, the people inside the city, they become so angry with the king that they chop off the king's head and went out and give the king's head to the prince, that thereby freed his mother. And because he have held this, the food, the people inside the city, including the king, they didn't have any food, they didn't have anything to drink, no access to water. So they suffered a lot from this thirst. And because of that, he had to wait 7 years with being born. He was the prince of receivers because of under a Buddha called Bhagavatamsara, he wished to be there, be foremost among the recipients. And under Vipassi Buddha, there was a competition between the king and, that was living at around Vipassi Buddha and the lay people about who could give most. And then Shivali, at that time a millionaire, he gave honey and sugar and yogurt good to thousands of monks for several years. And because of this extreme giving, he later became a prince of receivers. He received so much that the Buddha, he once should travel up to a Himalaya region where he where it was known that there was very sparse of people and very few that could give food. Then he brought Shivali with him. And then these circumstances, these probabilities, they acted so that a deva, he provided them with milk rice for 7 days, himself, the Buddha, and 250 monks that was wandering up on in this very desolate area, arid area of Himalaya. So he kind of like brought this receiver with him to receive something. Unfortunately, this that he's a receiver has given rise to people of blind superstition think that if they wear an amulet with Shivali, which you see here, and the amulets you can see here, examples on, and they think superstitiously that this is good for commercial activities. They will be a receiver like Shivali. But this is not the case because they didn't do what Shivali did. They didn't give milk and honey and sugar to thousands of monks in competition with a king before. So this is blind superstition. They cannot tap his karma. And this these amulets, which are very popular in Thailand among Thai lay people, to buy from Thai monks who make the amulets, of which there are thousands and there are collectors of them. This is actually wrong livelihood for a monk. I'll just read about what is wrong livelihood so lay people can realize that if you buy this from a monk, then this is definitely not a pure livelihood. This is not a pure monk. I just say that the Buddha also spoke at Dhammapada about Shivali Theta, and it goes like this. The one who has crossed the swamp of delusion and rebirth so difficult to pass, who has gained the other far shore, transcendent and all beyond, who is absorbed in meditation, calmed, who is freed from lust, doubt, and all craving, who has cut off all clinging, to Nibbana fully gone, such one I call a holy one. To Nibbana fully gone, such one I call a holy one. This is said about the Arahant Theta Sivali. The explanation of right livelihood for Buddhist monks and nuns. Neither living nor receiving food by astrology, soothsaying, prediction of future events, nor by palmistry, geomancy, dream reading, charms or spells, amulets, or fake divination, nor by any rituals, running errands or messages, political flatter, arranging marriages, funerals or divorces, medical praxis, nor by producing art or poetry, nor by professional disputation or debate, that is right livelihood. So if a monk or a nun engages in any kind of these activities, then it's wrong livelihood. This means that this person doesn't follow the Noble Eightfold Way. These amulets, that is blind superstition, is called animism, because the people who buy these amulets for thousands of dollars, they believe that inside the amulet itself is some power that it will give them special luck. This is not the case. There's nothing inside this amulet other than plastic and copper and whatever it's made of. It has no connection to the individuality of Sivali. So it doesn't work. It doesn't work. Some claim it works, but there's other circumstances that works. But it has nothing to do with this. Same thing about other ritual practices, which is clinging to mere rules and rituals, a samyujana, a mental fetter, which obstruct understanding, creates ignorance, and hinders the way to nirvana. Silabhata paramasa, clinging to mere rule and ritual, blind ritualism. Like somebody believe if they bathe in a holy river, then they can wash out their sins, they can wash out their bad karma. But this is not the case. Mental impurity, mental defilement cannot be washed out by water and soap. There has to be other methods, like meditation. This is the soap, but muddy flood water cannot do it. Also, funny paintings and taking a skeletons, as you see pictures of here, or other kinds of often very colorful clothing and mystical behavior, this has nothing to do with the holy thing. There's nothing holy in that. It is a very safe and good predictor of complete ignorance, blind superstition, but also very colorful. You can say the larger the head is of the holy man, the longer the beard is, the more colorful face coloring, the larger the ring in the nose is, or whatever it is, of all this paraphernalia. That's this man who's empty inside, like an empty bowl, so he has to kind of like punk up his external appearances by all kinds of religious theater in order to impress lay people enough to keep him going by giving him gifts and food. So these people are not holy at all. They are very, very ignorant, and it's very blind superstition that forms these practices of amulet making and religious bathing and all kinds of other blind ritualism. This one should stay long way from. I think this will do it for today. I'll give a link below on Venerable Sivali so you can go and read up him for yourself. And then I of course also like to say thank you to the supporters, both those who gave food, and the regular supporters, and the occasional supporters. And if you want to support, then I have a Patreon support page. It's on the YouTube. There's a small P, red P. Just click the red P or there is a Patreon link down in the description on the video, or search Patreon, P-A-T-R-E-O-N, and Samahita, then you'll find the support page of these videos and audios, which are reaching more than 100,000 people every day and every week. Remember to click subscribe if you're not already all subscribed. And then I will say, still, Happy New Year. I think that 2017 will be a very, 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 very happy year. At least for me personally. But it's still to be seen whether that is correct or not. Thank you for your attention. And have a nice day. Namo. Tasso. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly, perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamateya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and help. And nice.